Good afternoon. A very welcome to all of you. Should we start the event, sir? It's 12:05, sir. People will join as and when, and a few of them have already joined. So can we start the event with all your permission, sir?
Sure. Okay. I'm fine, thank you.
All right. Okay, so welcome one and all. I welcome all the esteemed panelists and the participants as well who've spared their Sunday noon for this event. For this very important discussion around the idea of procedural justice and conventional morality and what kind of nexus exists between law and journalism. We often read about the right to freedom of speech and the rights that media has, with the recent Nobel Peace Prize being awarded to two journalists. This idea of journalism counteracting authoritarianism has become more prominent than ever before. And again, the idea of law is also essentially to limit state, limit its powers and to protect this liberty and rights of citizens, which means that there is a necessary nexus between law and journalism. But how does law and journalism work in complete synchronization to ensure that justice prevails? That's the very idea that we will tackle with. We have a great set of panelists to address this question. We have Mr. Shyam Dewan, Mr. Kaleshwaran Raj, and then we also have Mr. Puranjay Guha, who is a veteran journalist. So we will have a discussion around this, and Avantika, who's a third year student of National Law School, will be moderating the discussion. So I request her to take the event ahead from here, and I once again welcome all the panelists and participants, and thanks a lot for joining us.
Before I proceed, am I audible and visible to everybody?
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Yes, Avantika.
Yes, please.
Yes, very good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to express my gratitude towards all the panelists and participants who have taken out the time on a Sunday afternoon to be a part of a much needed discussion organized by the Law and Society Committee in alignment with its advocacy of rekindling critical thinking and effectuating positive societal changes thereafter. As I have already been introduced, I'm Avantika, and I'm a third year law student at the National Law School of Indian University. And I'm present here in the capacity of a member of the Law and Society Committee. I welcome everybody to this panel discussion today, which will deal with the manner in which sensationalized journalism and media trials influence the legal and judicial processes in India. I'm sure that most, if not all of us, are aware of the media storm that surrounded the demise of a popular Bollywood actor in June 2020. Now, while this storm prima facie sculpted the popular opinion on the consumption of drugs and how power dynamics play out in the Indian film industry at large, a more insidious effect of the storm lies in its revelation of the dark underbelly of media houses and their insatiable appetites for achieving the highest quantum of television ratings as possible. Over the past 1 year, the entire episode has played out in great gory detail for everybody to see. And the media, which is often touted as the fourth pillar of democracy, has gradually fallen prey to the exact kind of mob mentality that it had generated in the public. Individuals that have been involved in the consumption or even simply in the dealing of drugs have been subjected to a form of moral condemnation in the court of public opinion for simply exercising their choices as adults, despite the lack of legal blameworthiness on their part in most cases. And this condemnation yet again manifested itself in the recent arrest of another Bollywood personality by the National Crime Bureau on 3rd October 2021. And amidst this line of thought, it's important that we not forget the problematic role that is essayed by the media in cases which involve the commission of abhorrent crimes against women, wherein the media is often seen as cultivating public statement against the accused in direct contravention to one of the fundamental tenets of the Indian criminal justice system, which is the presumption of innocence. These media trials prejudice the opinion of the public by painting out the accused as guilty until proven innocent. And in addition to the denunciation of alleged assailants in such cases, media trials often end up severely impinging upon the victim's right to privacy under the Constitution of India. It so appears that now the only saving grace is that the Lady of Justice is sightless. For if she could actually observe the gradual but steady decline of how our moral standards and how our conventional morality as a society has degraded, her head would undeniably hang in disappointment and shame. And with that being said, I'd like to reintroduce our esteemed panelists that have very graciously agreed to enlighten us all on significant aspects of sensationalized journalism and media trials in India. Our very first panelist is Senior Advocate Shyam Divan. Sir is a distinguished lawyer who has amassed years of experience before the High Court of Bombay and the Supreme Court of India. His area of practice encompasses constitutional law and most branches of civil litigation, including banking and securities law, arbitration, administrative law, and environmental law. He has also been appointed as the Vice President of the Bar Association of India, and he has served as the Vice President of Law Asia and the co-chair at the Human Rights Section of Law Asia. He has contributed to several organizations that have made various contributions in the areas of public interest, and he's a prolific author that has written extensively on public interest litigation and environmental law. He's also notable for appearing in several contemporary constitutional cases that have shaped the development of constitutional law in India. And to name a few of them, we have Justice K.S. Puttaswamy versus the Union of India, the Indore Development Authority versus Manoharlal. I request whoever is unmuted to please mute themselves. And in addition to the above, Divan has also served a wide variety of key roles in the legal domain, and he has assisted the Supreme Court as amicus curiae in a suo motu action that was initiated by the court for filling vacancies in the subordinate judiciary and in the Bailey case involving.
Avantika, I'm sorry to interrupt. Uttara, can you please? Can you please mute this? Uttara? Please go on, Avantika. Thank you. Sorry for the interruption.
So, as I was saying, that Mr. Divan has discharged a wide variety of key roles in the legal domain, as he has assisted the Supreme Court as amicus curiae in a suo motu action initiated by the court for filling vacancies in the subordinate judiciary and in the Bellary case involving illegal ore mining in the forests of Karnataka. Welcome, sir, and thank you so much for being a part of this panel. Moving on to our second panelist, we have Advocate Kaleshwaram Raj. Sir is an Indian lawyer practicing in the Supreme Court of India and the High Court of Kerala. He has successfully argued for the decriminalization of the offense of adultery under Section 497 of the Indian Penal Code in the landmark case of Joseph Schein versus Union of India, as he appeared as the lead counsel for the petitioner. He has also appeared before the Supreme Court of India in the government advertisements case, the National Highway Liquor Ban case, the Kerala Liquor Policy case, and he has also been appointed as amicus curiae in various cases. He also appeared for the victims of the Endosulfan tragedy in the Kasargod district in Kerala. And in that case, he was able to convince the Supreme Court in directing the Kerala government to pay compensation for child victims. Welcome, sir, and thank you so much for being here with us today. And finally, we have our very esteemed third panelist, Sir Paranjoy. And Mr. Guha, he had his education, he pursued his undergraduate degree in economics from St. Stephen's College and completed his master's from the Delhi School of Economics in 1977. And from that point of time, he has had a really illustrious career in journalism, wherein he's been associated with major media houses such as Business India, Business World, The Telegraph, India Today, and even The Pioneer. And in his capacity as a filmmaker, he's directed a number of documentary films such as The Cold Curse, Blood and Iron, A Story of the Convergence of Crime, Business and Politics in Southern India, In the Heart of Our Darkness, The Life and Death of Mahendra Karma. He also has co-authored a number of books, some of which are A Time of Collisions, Divided We Stand, Gas Wars, Crony Capitalism and the Ambanis, and most importantly, a book on media ethics. Additionally, Mr. Guha has never backed down and always acted in the cause of honest journalism, despite having faced threats against his work for proceeding honestly and trying to write about corruption and highlight the kind of irregularities that have existed in the coal market in India. And before I yield the floor to our esteemed panelists, I'd like to lay out the roadmap for how we can proceed in this discussion. So I humbly request all the panelists to present their valuable insights on the topic for around 15 minutes each. And after all the panelists have spoken, we'll have a brief but interactive question and answer session wherein all participants will be able to resolve any clarifications or any queries that they might have had in the discussion. And with that, over to you, sir.
Thank you very much for that very generous introduction. Greetings to all of you. I particularly my distinguished co-panelists. I'm going to leave all the enlightenment which you are expecting to the other two. I'm just going to be able to share a few of my thoughts and insights because, frankly, when I started scribbling a few notes on this very interesting subject, justice on a tightrope from newsroom to the courtroom, I found that my views were evolving as I was penciling something on a sheet of paper. So I'm not quite sure where to, that I have a firm view on any of this eventually, but I'll make a few suggestions in the course of my presentation. I thought maybe I should just start with setting out some, you know, fairly benchmarks. And the first set of fairly elementary benchmarks that I thought I'll place and then we could discuss it further is which are the callings we are dealing with. So I think we're dealing with three callings over here: the calling of a lawyer, the journalist, and the judge. I think these are the three primary callings. And when I'll have something to say on each one of them, but let me just flag some of the other points. Apart from these three callings, I think we're also looking at two, at least, different sets of stakeholders. The first, of course, is the public at large, which has a huge interest. And as you outlined, a need really to know not just the news, but also have the advantage of analysis, criticism, insights, because just to unpack what's happening in the world around us. So I think that's a huge stakeholder. And the other set of stakeholders whom I could identify are the accused, because there are different types of cases, but I think the biggest impact in terms of media trial is in a criminal action. You would have, of course, media trials also and views being expressed in other types of cases, civil cases. You could have constitutional cases which are sub judice, and therefore the question arises as to how much can you comment. But I think in terms of the most adverse impact is probably potentially what you have is insofar as people who are accused. And in this bucket of accused, I can identify at least two sets of accused. One is those who are accused by the media and in the eye of the media. And there is another set who eventually come to be accused by the investigation agency under our system. And then the third point I want to just flag is the overarching values that we have. And here I would like to divide the set of values into two broadly. One are those which we associate with the Constitution of India. The Constitution has worked pretty well for us so far. And with all its changes and modifications, I think we can be justifiably proud that we work constitutions with reasonable efficiency and reasonable ability. So the two constitutional values which come to the fore are the rule of law, which, although an expression not expressly used in the Constitution, is derived from a large number of our articles and provisions. rule of law versus, you know, rule by law, which is just much more basic and rudimentary and follow the rule book, but doesn't really imbibe the essentials of justice and fairness, which the rule of law does require. And then there is the fundamental right to free speech. Of course, in the context of criminal trials, there's also Article 21, that all important right to life, which our judges have really expanded in ways without parallel anywhere else in the world. So we have the fundamental rights, we have rule of law, and then I take up on what was mentioned just a moment ago by Avantika in the context of limited government. I think that's very, very important. I think it's an extremely important value when we think of fashioning remedies and deciding on the way forward. It's an expression which you do find used in constitutional bench judgments of the Supreme Court. But at least as a practitioner in that court, I find that oftentimes, even amongst the best and most experienced of judges, when you raise a value like limited government, they're not quite sure as to what you're talking about. And part of it is because our experience as citizens has been, and we tend to lean on the government and the state for so much that we expect that this is a benign state, which is made by us, created by us, sanctioned by us in terms of the constitutional document, which we adhere to. And therefore, it can really do no harm to us except in some minor manner. I do have an issue with that. I think limited government as a value is very important. And I think on the way forward, in terms of constitutional jurisprudence and just in terms of constitutional sensitivity, I think it's very important that we bring about this value of limited government. And also keep it in mind when we're fashioning a solution in the context of these media trials which are taking place. What I'm getting at basically is that, look, we have enough problems with the state and the state being invasive and being all powerful. And if we are to come up with a solution which is better than the present state of affairs, perhaps it should involve as little of the state as we can possibly design. And then I think I come to non-constitutional values, values which are far more permanent than our constitution. And those are, I think, the value of justice, which of course you find mentioned in the preamble to the constitution. But I think justice is far wider. I mean, you can toss out the constitution, but you can't toss out justice. And similarly, I think I'd put your point regarding presumption of innocence right up there along with justice, because that's also, you know, very, very basic to the whole march of civilization and the growth of us as communities, as nations, as peoples, and as we move forward and we at least perceive ourselves as advancing at a civilizational level. So having set out these points, I thought, let me just mention a few issues. The first is, I think we need to go back to who we are. If we are advocates, if we are lawyers, I think we have to, in terms of what we can do and what we should do, adhere to the rules that which are the rules of professional conduct and the rules of etiquette, which have a statutory sanction. And I think we shouldn't forget these rules. So as you know, they are to be found in the framework of our Advocates Act. And we have a specific chapter and a section with regard to what we can as lawyers do. It's mentioned in the Bar Council of India Rules, Part 6, Chapter 2. And here in these standards of professional conduct and etiquette, what you will notice is that there hasn't really been an amendment to deal with the present situation for a really long time. And I think this lends itself. So we have Rule 15, which speaks of, you know, the duties of an advocate, etc., that we shouldn't be doing anything using improper and illegal means. And we'll I think that does arise when advocates depart from the cases which they're doing. And I think that I will speak to very briefly in terms of, we have a certain conventional role, but then by virtue of the society in which we live, there is this enormous celebrity culture. That's a big problem. And therefore the enormous attraction of saying something either on television or in the media, other media. And apart from celebrity culture, we now have influencers, and, you know, both in terms of lawyers and journalists, neither of these are professions which necessarily lack in vanity. So we think considerably more of ourselves than we really are. And we then have this whole temptation for crossing over into something bigger and larger roles. It may be politics, it may be in terms of a larger role. And I think the whole advantage and joy of a free society is that it allows us to do so. But then what you find, and I think this is true of journalists also, who sort of play these crossover roles beyond their conventional bounds, is that you're no longer adhering to, as in the case of lawyers, we have, of course, the Bar Council of India rules, where there are gaps, as I mentioned, because they haven't been updated. And as far as media persons and journalists are concerned, we also have a set of guidelines over there in the Norms of Journalistic Conduct 2010, which was drafted in the wake of certain big incidents in terms of reporting on terrorists, etc. And there's a whole section in paragraph 21 of the guidelines on trial by media and what journalists can or ought to do and what they ought not to do. So that's to some extent, at least, available in terms of do's and don'ts. The issue then, in terms of what, how do we say, move forward? And here I want to use an expression which I suddenly found, I think one of you mentioned from an extended CV, which I should, I think, curtail. I was attending a human rights conference just a few days ago, and there was a section on Myanmar. There was a report on human rights situation in the Philippines. And there was also a presentation with regard to what we are now seeing, where spyware is being used by governments against their own citizens, etc. And one expression I heard over and over again, and that expression was impunity. So, I mean, it's very easy to characterize this in terms of the junta in Myanmar, where the generals and the army is just, you know, riding roughshod, completely secure in the belief that nothing at all can happen to them. And therefore, for those of us who are interested in advancing human rights, for expanding them, for ensuring that we have justice in within reach, I think it's extremely important to have systems in place where people are brought to account and face punishment or have to face a price. And I see that in the context of media trials, the situation that is obtaining at present, whether it's a television anchor or whether it's an irresponsible set of journalists on a medium, which is, and you know, this whole problem about fake news, etc., is there is complete impunity. There is no fear that you are ever going to be brought to justice in any manner and pay the price for your indiscretions and complete illegalities in terms of, you know, destroying a person's life, reputation, prejudicing the manner in which he or she will be perceived by a court or a judge or even in an appellate forum. So where do I come out at the end of these 12 or 13 minutes? The first thing which I would suggest is we perhaps require a restatement of values and principles for lawyers and journalists to bring it up to date. And when I speak about a restatement of values and principles, it's probably something for a forum like the Law and Society Committee to probably initiate a process. There are standards which are available in other jurisdictions. They're not necessarily very clear, but you know, you have free speech jurisdictions such as the United States, a very strong free speech jurisdiction. And nevertheless, you have guidances from the American Bar Association over there available on what lawyers can do and cannot do. And I think we need to tailor these or borrow these from the best of jurisdictions across the world and come up with a restatement of principles and values. And then what? The Bar Council of India rules, as I mentioned to you, they have been amended, but not in this regard at all since they were framed in the 1970s. So perhaps a better way of going about it, since we don't want to, at least I don't want the state to impose X or Y or Z, is perhaps some sort of a campaign amongst bar associations across the country. You start with a few leading bar associations. And to get their lawyers and to get their members of these bar associations to adopt and adhere to this restatement of principles and values, which should be more than probably two or three pages, but it has to be done. Now that's on the lawyer part of it. But I think we need to go a little further. And because media is not just plays such an important role, but we're finding these intersections at every juncture, every day when you read the newspapers or watch a television program. And I think we need a new institution at not some great and grand statutory level. In fact, the answer to that is no. But you may require some kind of an institutional machinery or mechanism which crosses. So we have the Bar Council, as far as the Press Council is concerned, but those are two separate streams. Perhaps on this aspect of media trial, because it's so important, both freedom of speech on the one hand, and we require something which is populated by personnel from these two streams and a representative of the general public. It straddles these two areas. They're people who are knowledgeable in the area. And then what are they to do? Well, one is they have to require an advice insofar as this is concerned. And the second is probably not just make recommendations, but have teeth. Now, how do you provide for that? Here again, what I would suggest is, and I come back to that expression, impunity. I think we need to have a system by which, at least at the initial stage, you have some of your larger media houses and media enterprises and whatever, even the smaller ones, but the ones which are effective and which are well known, to come together to form some sort of a panel where an individual can secure quick and swift redress. And this has to be, amongst other things, a redress in the form of monetary recompense. So none of us want the slap suits and none of us want those actions by which we terrorize journalists into reporting. But if we have a set of reasonably objective standards, one, and number two, we are able to create some sort of a institutional machinery, maybe initially ad hoc, maybe across media and lawyers, etc., where the media voluntarily comes forward, then at least a person who's defamed, a person whose reputation has been completely in tatters, can come forward without using the non-existent or only theoretically existent court system in India to secure some sort of redress. So those are my opening remarks and comments. Thank you very much for this opportunity.
Thank you so much, sir, for your valuable insights on this topic. And it's really important to actually acknowledge the way that we contextualize the entire debate in terms of how there need to be practical changes brought about in rules. Is my voice clear?
Vandika, your voice has been breaking up.
Okay, so I shall switch off my video and perhaps it should get better. Is it better now, sir?
Indeed.
Yes, sir. So as I was saying, that it's really important to acknowledge that sir just recontextualized the entire debate in terms of how we can make practical amendments to the BCI rules and have some institutional machinery in place which will make sure that any flagrant disobedience of law and regulations that of media ethics that journalists and lawyers have to follow, like that is ensured to the full extent as possible. Also, we need to acknowledge the point about monetary recompense that large media houses need to actually take this initiative, and we alone as individuals would not be able to effectuate such a level of change on our own. So we need that kind of lobbying from large media houses so that they actually come together and compensate the person that has been severely impacted in terms of reputational injuries and so. And with that, I'd like to request our second panelist, Mr. Raj, to enlighten us on this topic.
Thank you, Ms. Avantika, Ms. Anshul, Sarthak, and a very warm good morning, or rather it's good afternoon, to my senior colleague, Mr. Shyam Divan, and the analyst, Mr. Paran Choi. It's a great pleasure to be among students always, especially to have some deliberation on a serious topic like media trade. And Mr. Shyam Divan has already given certain vital areas pertaining to the topic which requires a good degree of deliberation right now as well as beyond this event. I'm thankful to Mr. Shyam Divan for that. He has laid down rather the thematic premises for the present deliberation. The moment the organizers, I should congratulate them also, the Law and Society Committee of the National Law School, Bangalore, suggested this topic, I was brooding over various facets of it. And I find, interestingly, right in a 1770 judgment, Lord Mansfield, who also apparently was troubled with some kind of media trail as it existed then at that point of time, he even wrote it in the judgment. If I quote Lord Mansfield, this is what he wrote. Quote, I pass over many anonymous letters I have received. Those in print are public, and some of them have been brought judicially before the court. Whoever the writers are, they take the wrong way. I will do my duty unaided, unquote. This Lord Mansfield has written in R versus Wilkes, 1770, in a case pertaining to murder of a journalist, whereupon also apparently there was some kind of media trial, but the trial, of course, was apparently unarmed by the kind of technological devices which the present media do have. But fact remains that right from time immemorial, pupil, journalists, students, non-lawyers, everybody had a kind of fascination towards crimes as well as criminal trials. Why that happens may require a lot of multifaceted answers. It may be due to the kind of theatrism involved in a crime, some kind of misdirected adventurism, and there may be sometimes a kind of action of a genius behind it. Whatever be the reason, fact remains that in an adversarial system, the court is rather concerning with rival versions. It is a thinker called Charles Taylor has described it as in it's a criminal trial or a litigation is like a zero-sum game, where the court ultimately is called upon to say either A is correct or B is correct in that. And if I recall the British Marxist, Terry Eagleton even said, I'm again quoting, in an adversarial system, what Terry said about the litigation, especially about the adversarial litigation, court. Courtrooms, like novels, blur the distinction from fact and fiction. The jury judge not on the facts, but between rival versions of them. He wrote this article, Eagleton wrote this article in Guardian on 25th May 2005. So this happens because you are reproducing the event based on versions, narratives and counter narratives. And in the process, we are supposed to have a search for truth, which sometimes may happen, which sometimes may not happen. But media trail has been always a matter of embarrassment, even before the technological advancement. Three prominent judgments of the Supreme Court are probably one, Re-Precision, which was decided in 1968. Then the Tandoori murder case, Sushil Sharma, 1996. And the relatively recent judgment in 2005 in MP Lohia. So ultimately, in the contemporary time, it so happens that we have a kind of tele-trial of each and everything happening, especially when cases pertaining to celebrities, as Mr. Divan rightly indicated in his speech. Apart from that, there is also the trial by social media, which again is something essentially uncontrolled. So the problems with media trial, I would try to identify, are essentially four in numbers. Number one, because since it's a kind of media, somebody described as an institutionalized anarchy, unlike the legal fraternity, which is essentially drastically controlled by the Advocates Act and the Bar Council rules, of course, though there is Press Council in their legislations. Ultimately, media has to act also as an institutionalized anarchy because it requires the freedom embodied in, protected by all means. There are certain more foundational things at stake when you start curtailing the media. It should be like that. But as a result, I understand there are four broad areas to be identified. Number one is that very often the so-called media trail is essentially, to a great extent, to an alarming extent, ill-informed. I was just reminded of a judgment which was delivered by a sessions court in Kerala recently in a very curious murder case, a strange murder case, whereby a husband caused cobra bites on the wife, was ultimately murdered after getting trained in the way in which the cobra should be taught to bite the person and after throwing away the cobra into the bedroom where the wife was lying. It's famous, called as Uttara murder case, which has become almost sensational. And the learned judge delivered the judgment finding the husband guilty and imposing double the life imprisonment apart from over and above other sentences on the husband. In the sentencing part of it, he did it essentially based on circumstantial evidence, which the links were so crucial and clear, justifying the conviction. And after the conviction, the learned judge decided to impose life imprisonment and other kind of imprisonment on the accused. So many discourses happened. Very many persons found fault with the judge for not imposing that penalty. And very many media houses took it as if a strange murder case is somewhat synonymous with the rarest of rare case, which actually it is not evident. The device used may be strange, but that in itself doesn't make it in the falling within the rarest of rare category. This is something which a lawyer or a law student will be easily able to understand and to articulate. But the persons carrying out this media trial in the panels may not be able to. And apart from that, one doesn't even get a clear idea regarding what is the reasoning given by the session judge in support of his sentencing part of the judgment. He readily relied on the Bachchan Singh judgment of 1980. And the Bachchan Singh, as we know, said two things. You can impose death penalty in, of course, in rarest of rare case, but that again is only secondary. The main thing which Bachchan Singh led to was probably the most important thing, was Bachchan Singh said that you can impose death penalty on an accused only when the alternative options are unquestionably foremost. This is something which has not been propagated even among the media circles, during the public discourse regarding death penalty. When the alternative options are unquestionably disclosed, or rather unquestionably foreclosed, ended, then only you can opt for death penalty. So situation where other options are unquestionably foreclosed practically puts an end to death penalty in the country. At least some persons will be able to question death penalty imposed on certain cause and grounds, as it always happens. From human rights perspective, from ethical perspective, from institutional perspective, and even from procedural perspective. But when you have a discourse on media trial, nobody talks about the clear reasoning given in support of punishment. It may satisfy the urge of the popular class if somebody is subjected to death penalty, but that is not what the law requires, what the presidential law requires in similar situations. So this ill-informed part is one area to be identified when we talk about the media trail. Secondly, there's a kind of inherent bias. That is a second area. When media carries out the discourse, especially among celebrity crimes, I read elsewhere that in celebrity crimes, the punishment rate is relatively high. There's a 12% increase. That's what a report says, a survey says, when it comes to the crimes or the alleged crimes committed by celebrities. Maybe due to various reasons, the judge may want the celebrity to be a model. There may be some kind of inherent prejudice against it, or rather envy against the life which the celebrity has been leading, and some kind of social moral compulsions. These are all playing as factors in enhancing the rate of conviction, especially in the area of celebrity crimes. Number three is evident. There is always a temptation for the media to commercialize itself. We are in the era of rating. The commercialization always happens, goes without saying. And number four, this is probably the area which I want to stress on. Unlike the media trials in the past, given the nature of polity in the contemporary India, there is a lot of communalization taking place. Lot of hate has almost become an ideology. And divisive politics also play into the things. And as a result, there is almost a kind of ministry of distraction for the regime in the contemporary world, especially in populist democracies, where we find a lot of abusive judicial review, where there is a kind of dictatorial practices. where the rule of law is facing immense challenges, people get distracted when there is a trial. You easily get distracted from the anti-CIA movement or the movement agitation against the contentious farm laws when there is a celebrity being tried for narcotic offense or some other offense, whatever. So media, unlike the olden times, is also working as political agents. And I think this fourth area, which I have tried to indicate, is something very important for from the law students' perspective of view. Because the law students are no longer mere students of law or constitution. They are also supposed to be the guardians of law, rule of law, as well as the constitutional values, especially in pathological times, in troubled times, like the times where we live in. So these four areas are to be identified first of all. The second, I will conclude with the second part of my submission that will fetch for some 2-3 minutes more. That is regarding the dialectics which the freedom of press faces when we talk about media trade. There is something undesirable. There is something intrinsically bad in the trial by media. There is no doubt about it. And in fact, I went through a study by BVLN Shastri. He's an Indian academic of Walden University. He conducted extensive surveys. He got the responses from very many sections of society, especially from trial lawyers. And one significant finding which he shares is that often it so happens that even judges have altered the findings due to the kind of influence by the media on a particular case, in a particular case, or an incident. This is something very alarming, which should not have happened. Mr. Shastri's paper is titled Influence of Trial by Media on the Criminal Justice System in India. It's a very comprehensive paper. And he gives examples of similar examples in abundance, which again are equally disturbing. So how do we find out a solution for that? There is a strong view already that there has to be further curtailment in how the media tackles it. And I am given to understand that there is already a public interest litigation pending in Bombay High Court, which essentially seeks to expand the scope of Section 3(2) of the Contempt of Court Act, bringing almost any kind of trial by the media in the negative sense into the ambit of Section 3 of the Contempt of Court. Equally strong is the advocacy for expanding the scope of sub judice jurisprudence. And meaning thereby you cannot have a discourse on a pending matter, not just criminal matter, but even as Mr. Diban indicated, constitutional matters or other civil matters, commercial litigation, you cannot have a discourse on that. My respectful view on this is this, with that I will conclude. The freedom of speech is something which has got an intrinsic value, which therefore requires to be protected. Therefore, any attempt to put an end to the liberty which the citizens enjoy, be it media persons, be it lawyers or law students or other sections of society, should be done with a sense of caution. Curtailment may be something appearing to be an easy solution, but once the freedom is curtailed in any degree whatsoever, it may be something extremely difficult to get restored. Therefore, we may have to find out a balanced solution for the menace. In Sahara judgment 2012, the Supreme Court rightly says that the best control, best regulation for the media will remain as the self-regulation. So self-regulation has to be maintained. Freedom of the media will have to be maintained. And then how to find out a solution for the menace? According to my humble view, it is to train the legal professionals and to enhance the professionalism. It may require a different kind of approach while you adjudicate a criminal matter in 2021, which is essentially fundamentally different from the tools which the judge was supposed to have 2-3 decades ago. There has to be a professional training. Separate the trial of criminal offenses, which became sensational, by taking those as belonging to a distinct category, including celebrity crimes or other sensational murders. In the present ecology of the media, that will require a separate and highly professionalized, modernized approach, for which the judges, right from the grassroots level to the higher judiciary, will have to be trained appropriately. And by enhancing that professionalism, and of course also by propagating about the limits and possibilities of opinion among the lawyers, among the non-lawyers, we will be able to strike a correct balance between the two freedoms or all freedoms. Ultimately, media trial will have to be realized as a menace, but its solution again is equally challenging. And while we prescribe solution, it is significant to enhance the professionalism of the system on the one hand, and to preserve the freedom of the media on the other. Thank you so much.